There are many claims to what is the first concept album. The idea of a record having a single narrative thread or unifying theme running throughout it. It's generally thought that Frank Sinatra was the first to create such an album with his Wee Small Hours of the Morning. This is a wonderful, melancholic record, with all of the songs themed around staggering home drunk, alone, and waking up in a Soho doorway sort of thing. The concept album idea gathered pace during the musical industrial revolution of the mid-60s, with albums starting to go beyond merely having a single theme, but having an actual storyline and characters in it, and with this, the rock opera was born. There are several albums which claim to be the first rock opera, the most frequent being the album SF Sorrow by the band Pretty Things. Like Tommy, this album opens with a First World War setting. It has a central character who's altered by witnessing the death of a loved one and ends up with people becoming disillusioned with the 60s utopia. With tracks like The Journey and I Can See You, it's easy to see at first glance how SF Sorrow may have influenced Tommy, and certainly the intro to its Old Man Going track is remarkably similar to Pinball Wizard. SF Sorrow predated Tommy's release by a year, and there are multiple stories about Townsend being a fan of the album, something that he has denied, claiming the fact to have never heard it. And with so much cross-pollination of ideas at stone parties, held by musicians who are all largely friends, it's difficult to be precise about who listened to what during this era and who influenced who, or even the Who. One of Pete's first forays into conceptual writing was in June 66 with an idea called Quads. This was a concept set in a future world where parents could choose the gender of their own children, with the central family in the story having four daughters but receiving only three, with an additional son instead. The track I'm a Boy is perhaps the best known relic from this concept, with the songs Disguises and Join My Gang that also contain themes about confused sexual identity also thought to have been part of this project. It's here perhaps that the seeds of the future Tommy's childhood trauma are first sown. By December 66, the release of the six-part Quick One Suite was further evidence that Pete's new conceptual songwriting could work on record, and by February 67, he was outlining a full-scale 25-track double album character-based rock opera. This unnamed idea could well have been an early draft for Tommy. It's more likely, however, it was an initial idea for the unreleased Rael Suite, which he was also developing around this time.
Now, Captain, you'll remember your instructions. Return to this point on Christmas Day and look towards the shore for my signal, and then you'll know if in Rael I'll stay.
Devised after a visit to Israel and witnessing the tension there, this opera had a more political plotline, with its central character fighting at sea against the communist Chinese government who had just invaded Israel. This perhaps overreaching idea ended up being the Rael track at the end of Sellout, with some musical themes from Tommy contained within it. Interviews from this time suggest that Townsend's mind was buzzing with multiple overlapping ideas, and perhaps the only thing that stopped them coming to fruition were time constraints, touring, album deadlines, and of course another idea entering his head. One concept for a live show was a song cycle called The Ages of Man, with songs linked to different eras in the band members' lives and reflecting their personalities, kind of like an extension of the My Generation track. Another idea was a song suite set in a lunatic asylum where the inhabitants King Rabbit, the Fat Lazy People and Happy Jack resided. Pete's opera idea was put on hold throughout the remainder of 67, while the band pursued unrelenting touring, side projects and the recording of their sellout album. Townsend was becoming ever conscious of the Who were being left behind by the rapidly maturing post-Pepper landscape. The days of the 3-minute pop single were numbered, and this was illustrated by the relative underperformance of their recent I Can See For Miles single. Pete knew that the answer lay in the album format and was searching low and high for inspiration and a new vibration. And like many in the rock community, he became interested in Indian spirituality, namely the teaching and wisdom of spiritual teacher Maya Barber. Barber was introduced to Pete by the eventual Tommy cover artist Mike McInerney by the book God Speaks, in which the guru described interconnections between himself, God and all others through a shared consciousness. Barber at this point was 43 years into a vow of silence, and it's this that provides the catalyst for Tommy, someone who also does not speak and finds alternative ways to communicate. It's from Barber that the idea of Tommy breaking free and becoming a spiritual guide himself also comes from. Pete spoke confidently and eloquently about Barber's spiritual concepts. Ever the raconteur, Townsend's abundant interviews reveal a highly intelligent and poetic person full of enthusiasm, with profound thoughts about life, politics and the human spirit, both in this life and beyond. His true genius, however, is how he was starting to marry up these weighty concepts in quirky and catchy music. This is perfectly illustrated in a number from early 68 called Little Billy, which was originally designed to be an Odorono style radio advert for an anti-smoking charity. Billy was big on the outside, and there's an even bigger man inside. Although some existing Who music like Glow Girl and Rael would be recycled into Tommy, Little Billy is perhaps our first taste of where Townsend was heading. Its opening guitar strums would be reused to open Tommy's overture, and its themes of Billy's bullying, oppression, and ultimate redemption would also colour much of Tommy's own life. Little Billy is doing fine. Another piece of the Tommy jigsaw falls into place in the spring of 68, when The Who went on tour accompanied by singer Paul Jones, who had recently starred in a film called The Privilege. This film centres around a pop star who becomes a messiah to his followers until they ultimately become disillusioned with him, and one can't help thinking that this also rubbed off on Pete, as it's a theme later echoed in Tommy. The following month, and the title Amazing Journey, the first song formally written for Tommy is revealed, and the concept of the deaf, dumb and blind kid is first mentioned. It's around this time, whilst in the spiritual calm of an Illinois Holiday Inn, Pete claims to have heard godlike voices that helped him fully see the idea for Tommy in his mind's eye. And that night he began drafting out the album's concept, and incredibly, the written notes for this, like much of his scribblings from this time, still survive, and it's here that Tommy is born. It's a boy, Mrs. Walker, it's a boy. It's a boy, Mrs. Walker, it's a boy.
It's a boy, Mr. Walker. You've got a baby boy. A son. A son. A son.
In August, the Rolling Stone magazine published a series of interviews in which Pete pretty much outlined all of the new album's story, then still titled The Deaf, Dumb and Blind Boy. The ideas from this huge interview suggest a bigger role for Tommy's father and his general disappointment in his son not being able to play football and the like. Tommy's perverted uncle and the doctor are also mentioned in this early draft that many feel was hurriedly improvised purely for the purpose of this interview. So much so that Townsend himself has later stated that he had to refer back to this interview to remind himself of what the story was actually all about. The narrative aspect of Tommy was perhaps the hardest part to develop during this early stage of development, and producer Kit Lambert created a mini novelization of the plot to help all concerned focus on how the story could develop. With Pete learning to compose on the piano around this time, writing was slower than usual. The rest of the band would listen to demos that he brought in and try and help him flesh them out. And over time, they all voiced a discontent with the constant reworking of the songs and the general vagueness of the story. They had no reason to be over-optimistic. The Beatles, after all, were openly fragmenting at this time, and also the crushing effect on Brian Wilson the Smiles' non-completion had would have been well known to Daltrey, Entwistle, and Beach Boy fanatic Moon especially. Certainly, if Tommy would have failed, it would have probably meant the end of The Who as a leading force in the emerging rock scene. This fear was perhaps felt by the band's US label, Decca, who, on waiting endlessly for Tommy, cast their chips in with a rush-released botched Magic Bus compilation. With the recording of the album beginning in September, the record company were peeping around the door in curiosity, expecting the album to be delivered in time for a Christmas release. However, this wasn't to be, with the band now planning to add an orchestra and also expanding it into a double album to allow the story to breathe more. Perhaps this orchestra idea accounts for the overall brevity and sparseness in the final production, and possibly the space reserved for the orchestration was probably just left in as the band and Lambert became used to it. Townsend has later commented that the album was due to have more guitar overdubbing, but somehow this also never happened. Either way, it's this serene and uncluttered aspect to the production which I personally feel makes the album work so well.
What about the boy?
Around this time, The Who's management, Track Records, had an office in London's Old Compton Street, and very near to this, on Charing Cross Road, there once stood an amusement arcade called the Lots of Fun, and this is where the album's pinball theme was born. Townsend has recalled playing there along with fellow pinball lovers Track Records' Kit Lambert and Chris Stamp, and they introduced Pete to the music writer Nick Cohen and a 15-year-old Canadian girl known simply as Arthur. Always playing clean and never tilting at all, Arthur was developing a reputation as a mean pinball player, so much so that Cohen was writing a book about her, and for a brief period she adorned many magazine covers and news articles.
How do you think he does it?
I don't know.
What makes him so good?
Arthur was set to become the resident bally table champ at Chris Stamp's London restaurant, The Trencherman, and an August edition of the Evening Standard references a Track Records album that's being made about her, titled The Teenage Pinball Queen. Other articles state that she had signed to Track Records, and reports that a song was being written about her. not by Pete, but by the perfect mentor and guiding hand for a young girl new in swinging London, the Stones' Bill Wyman. In late 68, writer Cohen and Arthur visited The Who and listened to a near-finished version of the Tommy album. Cohen liked it, but he felt that it lacked not only a true hit single, but was also a bit too preachy, and lacked humour and a quirky hook. Inspired by this and knowing that Cohen would approve of the result, Pete diluted some of the weighty Barber-inspired spirituality and instead replaced it with Pinball, rewriting many of the existing songs to fit this new narrative. Arthur and Tommy share many similarities, including stepping through a mirror to pass from one reality to another.
Even on my favorite table, he can't beat my best. His disciples lead him in, and he just does the rest. He's got crazy flipper fingers, never seen him fall. That deaf, dumb and blind kid sure plays a mean pinball.
There is, however, some doubt into the validity of Arthur's personal story, and some think that the girl could have just been a hired model or even a prostitute hired by the writer as a stunt to publicise his book, with an entire backstory just being completely fabricated. Either way, this unsung hero of Tommy became immortalised when The Who's career-defining Pinball Wizard song was finally released in March 69 as a curtain raiser for their new album. The song was a huge hit, however, without the full context of the still unreleased album. Some writers questioned the taste in having a disabled person as its leading figure, and wondered if Townsend's choice of subject matter was somehow being disrespectful or exploitative in some way. The album's track selection and sequencing was still being tweaked at this late stage, and Townsend has later referenced a desire to redo the ending of the album especially, something that he felt was rushed. Knowing that the album had to be played live, the band spent the last month before its release simultaneously rehearsing it and doing the final mixing, presumably making adjustments to both at the same time. It was in early May, on the eve of the album's final release, that a live performance to friends and the press was given. It was ecstatically received, and a full year on since Pete's initial idea, the band's new album was finally complete.
Success, I think we have success, I think we have success.
Just prior to Tommy's release, Pete gave an interview on what he likened the format of The Who's new album to being, lo and behold, just like the Pretty Things' SF Sorrow. You know, that original concept album that he supposedly never heard of. Tommy went through many changes throughout his development, with the original idea being that tracks would move between the harsh reality of Tommy's life and a fantasy world that he alone experienced. Tommy was originally to undergo Barber-inspired cycles of birth and rebirth, gaining new knowledge with each. So these reincarnations, that were called dream songs, would feature abstract sounds and reoccurring themes from other tracks, but it was felt that what looked good on paper may have just jarred for the listener. There are several tracks that, although planned and sometimes recorded, didn't make it onto the final record, the first of which is Young Man Blues.
Well, a young man ain't got nothing in the world these days.
This song was referenced by the band as being on the album as late as a month prior to its release. It was a live favourite around the time and originally planned to go on side two amongst the Cousin Kevin and Uncle Ernie childhood songs, presumably echoing the discontent that the teenage Tommy felt. Another old blues song called One Room Country Shack was also recorded, but presumably swapped for the better themed Eyesight to the Blind. Trying to get through, I suppose that Townsend original sounds very much again like an old blues standard before it ventures off into a kind of rough jam. Certainly, the lyrics to this about someone trying to communicate with Tommy could have fit easily into Side 2's narrative. The song The Girl from Lincoln County is a mystery, with Pete's initial notes suggesting that the gypsy woman, later to become the Acid Queen, would sing this part. The track Now I'm a Farmer was reported in mid-68 as featuring on the Tommy album. With its back to basics lyrics, it may well have sat in the latter part of the album as Tommy finds a welcome solitude and a new life with the comfortable people.
Now I'm a farmer and I'm digging, 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 digging.
The track Beat Up, or I Was Beat Up, is thought to have been a short vocal chant that may have led into Cousin Kevin, or its earlier incarnation, Cousin Kevin Model Child. This more light-hearted early version of Cousin Kevin was presumably shelved once John Entwistle was invited to write the songs about Tommy's bullying and sexual abuse. This is because really they were subjects that Pete had unfortunately been the victim of in his own childhood. As it happens, Entwistle's trademark dark humour gives the album a welcome, harder and unsettling edge that this early version lacks.
I'll babysit my cousin and I promise not to tease him, oh no. I'll caress his little haircut and do everything to please him, oh.
The Kevin in question was based on a real bully that Entwistle knew as a child. I'd love to know if this guy ever got to hear the song and how he felt knowing that John had ultimately had the last laugh.
Kevin's a model child, always as good as gold. Kevin is never wild, always does as he's told.
The final track omitted from Tommy is the most baffling. This phenomenal number, again by Entwistle, must have been held in high regard as it was played for a full year before Tommy's release as a kind of punch-in-your-face show opener. Recorded in the studio around this time, Heaven and Hell could have easily been woven into the Tommy concept, with Entwistle's lyrics mirroring Tommy's of Elevation to Messiah, Eternal Life, and subsequent Fall from Grace.
If you've been a bad boy.
Most of these unreleased tracks may have occupied the space on Side 2, ultimately filled by the 10-minute underture. One can only imagine that as the scope of the album grew, along with Pete's confidence, that the band felt that they could move away from comedic, country rock flavoured songs into more progressive and orchestral sounding structures. On release, the album reached number 2 in the UK charts and number 7 in the US. The sales far exceeded the recent sellout album, and to date, Tommy has sold over 20 million copies. Critical opinion at the time was mostly positive, with some heralding it as the birth of a new art form, something that took rock to a new level. Some reviewers, however, considered it to be overblown and pretentious, and perhaps over time its legacy has been slightly overshadowed by other concept albums and other Who albums for that matter. In terms of future-proofing the band, the creation of Tommy was a masterstroke, and overnight it allowed them to equal and in some ways surpass their rivals. Knowing that The Who could never compete with the Beatles in terms of songwriting, studio craft and cultural influence, Townsend instead knew that the key to their success was live playing. And to this end, Tommy gave them the perfect vehicle for this, with the live Tommy arguably surpassing the original studio recording.
Come to this house. Into this house.
The shows gave Roger Daltrey especially the confidence to step out of the shadows finally and become the blueprints for the 70s rock god, with a style and swagger that has been emulated by others for decades. Townsend was well aware of the emerging progressive scene at this time, and he wrote a full-page advert for King Crimson's debut in 1969. However, as much as he perhaps wanted, the Who would never sit comfortably in the emerging underground progressive scene. Their quirky, cartoon-like anarchy just didn't lend itself to Prog's Tolkien-esque imagery and late-night candlelit pondering. While Tommy doesn't sound like progressive rock in the traditional sense, whatever that truly is, the genre owes it a huge debt. It's shown the complex, intertwining song cycles and long-form narrative writing could not only have spiritual depth, but also long-lasting commercial appeal. In this sense, bands like Yes, Genesis, and Pink Floyd all built on Tommy's foundations. Although not alone, there's no doubt in the late 60s that Pete Townshend and the rest of The Who were at the forefront of pushing the doors of perception open even more to welcome us all in.
I'm your wicked Uncle Ernie, I'm glad you won't see or hear me as I fit.